Hello. I'd like to acknowledge my co-applicant on this, Dr. Terrell Lee McHugh, and as well the undergraduate and mainly graduate students who formed the research team that enabled us to do the work. So as you can see from my title, we did a sport-based critical hours program for low-income youth. I hope you'll indulge me. I'm going to talk about my own research and the research I've been involved with. I realize there's other research out there, but in this 15 minutes when we're asked to talk about our own research, that's kind of what I focused on. For the last few years, we've been looking at issues associated with sport participation for kids from low-income families. There's a few reasons for this. You might know that in Canada, arguably, direct public funding for sport programs is relatively low if you compare it to countries in Scandinavia or Japan. There's direct public funding. So in Canada, the number one barrier to sport participation is cost. So we've been looking at some issues relating to the possible benefits of sport participation when provided to children from low-income families. We've been looking more into the barriers that exist beyond the initial cost, and a variety of different studies. We've also done things like, with my colleague John Spence at the University of Alberta, we've looked at the Canadian Fitness Tax Credit, the CFTC. I've written that sentence, the bullet point, a little bit too strongly there. We found that the Canadian Fitness Tax Credit is more of a benefit to higher and middle-income families, and although low-income families are more aware of the credit, they're less likely to use it because they don't have the financial outlay in the first place to put the money out there. For this particular study that was funded through the Sport Participation Initiative, we focused on the critical hours period, so what's being become known as the critical hours period after school. So let me give you a little bit of a rationale for why look at the after school period. So there's data to show the after school period is a critical window for the promotion of physical activity. Kids only accrue an average, Canadian children only accrue an average of 14 minutes of physical activity between the hours of 3 and 6. And this is a time when they could be active because it's after school, they don't have the same constraints on their leisure time, you know, they're free from the constraints of school. So it's a perfect window of opportunity for physical activity. Except Canadian kids do not engage in sufficient physical activity at this time. You also know that only fewer than 10% of Canadian kids meet the 60 minutes per day recommended guideline, moderate to vigorous physical activity. There's other things. This is from the Active Healthy Kids Canada report card on physical activity for Canadian children and youth. And they highlight the importance of critical hours for, and I realize you can't quite make this out, but this is a graph about youth accused of crime in Canada. And you can see, hopefully, from this that it's actually youth are more likely to be the victims or the perpetrators of crime during the critical hours period. I wasn't looking at crime, but there are several reasons why this after-school period is arguably important to look at. So I'll just take a pause. On Friday, I presented at a conference in Lake Louise for physical activity and recreation practitioners, and I used the same introduction and then went on to say, and we need to look at active play in the after-school period. What I'm doing now is using the same introduction and saying, we need to look at organized programs in the after-school period. The point is, there's no magic solution here. The after-school period is an important time to look at. And there's different types of programs. So what we did was we created, implemented, and did some initial evaluation of a sport-based after-school program delivered to kids from in low-income areas of Edmonton. This was it's kind of a new thing for me. It was a very collaborative, community-oriented type of research. It's not the evaluation of an intervention. It's more the story of how we developed the program, some of the challenges we faced, and some of the benefits that may have occurred. So I'm not going to go through the methods in the way you might do in a normal presentation. I'm going to try and give you an overview, and really it's about telling a story about this research. It kind of started in about 2005. I teach an undergrad class that, and I make the students go out and do evaluations of physical activity opportunities in their neighborhood, and I make them go down to the inner city. And in about 2005, we went down one cold winter morning and just happened to make a connection with a principal at one of the inner city schools in one of the lowest income areas of the city. And from there, we developed connections with other people, members of the school board, a school board trustee, and did a few different types of projects. This is the community involvement part. We got to the point, the school we went to work with got shut down, and which is part of my record of working with organizations and then they get shut down. That's not the first time. We realized it was coming from the teachers. They wanted stuff in the after-school period. They said kids need stuff in the after-school period. We wrote the justification for the grant backwards. We heard from the teachers that this is what people wanted, and then we could write a good justification that critical hours is important. So they wanted after-school programs for kids, and they wanted partnerships with the university. And if you work at a university, these kind of things are a bit tough to do, especially a research-intensive university. So with the help, particularly one of the graduate students, we started to try and do a little bit of programming based on community need. So we actually started with some summer camps. And from the summer camps, they were delivered free in partnership with nonprofit agencies in the inner city neighborhoods. We then developed our first iteration, and this is a kind of participatory action research project, and you'll see it's pretty heavy on the action. We developed the first iteration of a program, which actually one of the kids called the After School Sport Kids Program. We delivered this in two different elementary schools that were selected by the with the assistance of the school board. They picked schools that they thought would be very receptive to a sport program, principals that would be very receptive to a sport program, and in locations that they thought were currently underserved by the school board in general. The first iteration of the program, we delivered it in two different schools, is twice a week, so Monday, Wednesday in one school, Tuesday, Thursday in another school, for about 12 or 14 weeks. And the kids would come in, they'd get a healthy snack. We had a partnership with the food bank to get some healthy foods, so the kids were hungry, so we'd give them a healthy snack. And then for the actual program, what we did first time around, we had partnerships with provincial sport organizations. So we would get people from provincial sport organizations to come in, and from fencing to rugby to soccer, and deliver sessions because we wanted to give the kids different types of activities. At the end of the so 35 children received the program. At the end of the program, we interviewed 28 of them, I think. And we asked them, and we also interviewed some of the adults, some of the teachers and the program providers who are involved with this. And we asked them for their opinions about what they liked, what they didn't like, and we used this to refine our approach and then go into the second phase of action. And at this point, we changed the name to try and give it a little bit of a different identity. And we made some decisions about the delivery. We, as the research team, made some decisions about the delivery. So the revised program, the second iteration, is called Try Sport, and we've been very clever using the word try because it sounds like three, and you'll see why in a second. We delivered it to younger children in two schools. We went to the younger children. If you work or have any interaction with people in schools, and particularly inner city schools, there's a real push to deliver programs to the younger children. We want the younger kids involved. We want the younger kids involved. So we went to, from kindergarten to grade three on our second time around instead of grades two and three. We felt it was unsustainable to keep the members of the PSOs coming in. It took out loads of time organizationally to bring sport organizations in just to arrange for them to turn up. So we took a different approach that might be more sustainable in the second time around. Where we delivered the programs ourselves. We focused on the fundamental movement stage, not because we love long-term athlete development plan. In fact, I've written against it, but more because that's what it is what it is, and it makes more sense to fit with the system that you're in. We went again to a couple of lowest income schools that it was extremely diverse group of kids, especially it was ethnically diverse, and particularly the schools we were in, there's a large, very new immigrant refugee population from Somalia. So In this second iteration, we focused on three sports. The idea being that we picked three sports that we thought would cover the most fundamental movement and sports skills that we could cover. So we picked volleyball, basketball, and soccer because there's a range of different movements there. And also, you don't need much equipment. You can actually run these sessions with just a ball. The schools did not have a lot of equipment. We picked three life skills to emphasize the goals. You can see in there teamwork, confidence, and leadership. I'm going to come back to the life skills in a second, but how we tried to teach these things were through reflection exercises. So for instance, at the end of a session, we would say to the kids, okay, talk about the teamwork that you learned today, that you did, you know, tell us a little bit about how you had to work in a team. Then we'd say, okay, think about how you might be able to use that teamwork in school tomorrow or when you get home. And then the next session, we'd ask them to tell kind of success stories. So did you use teamwork in school? Can you tell us about that? Did you use it at home? Can you tell us about that? So simple reflective exercise is actually based in the literature. We focused on intrinsic motivation. I won't bore you with the details, but we basically followed a cognitive evaluation theory approach. We focused on the provision of choice. We tried to create optimal challenges. We focused on self-improvement as opposed to comparison with others in the delivery. And we also used activities designed to engage children's imagination based on the work, if you know Andy Anderson, who used to be a prof at U of T, some of his ideas. So what did we find? I'm just going to run through the benefits first, then I'm going to reflect on some of the challenges, and then I'm going to kind of talk about so what a little bit. So the way we delivered the program, working with the schools and the teachers, we didn't want the kids who were the jocks, who'd just sign up for this anyway, who were doing sport anyway. We actually had the teachers target kids who they thought would really benefit from the program, but might not have other opportunities. So needless to say, the kids who received the program talked about, these were great, it was a great new opportunity. They did things in the program that they would not have the opportunity to do otherwise because, and they tell us things like, our parents don't have any money, or I wouldn't be able to get to a program, and things like that. So the program provided new opportunities. That's the first thing. The optimal challenges and adventures seem to be well-liked. So instead of just tossing a ball in the air, tossing coconuts in the air, doing our Amazon adventure, was more engaging. So it was more of, I would argue, developmentally appropriate pedagogy that seemed to be well received by the children. We had some success in relation to fundamental movement skills and sports skills, and I actually skipped a bit here. After Trisport, we spoke to the kids and the teachers to evaluate what they thought the benefits were. I think the biggest thing, and this is our observation rather than, you know, hard empirical data, soccer was the example that after we left, the kids started playing soccer. They didn't play before because according to one of the teachers, they didn't really know how to play. And after we left, they would ask for the soccer ball and play during recess times. So I'm going to come back to the kids didn't really know how to play. When we look at the life skills we tried to target, I gave the example of teamwork before because teamwork went quite well for us. Kids could give us examples in the interviews of teamwork. Teachers could say that they'd seen examples of teamwork in school. So teamwork, the kids seem to learn about teamwork. And this fits with actually other research we've done, other research that other people have done that found teamwork and social skills are probably the most robust findings associated with sport participation in terms of the life skills we might see. So we saw some good examples of teamwork, and we saw some potential for transfer to a school and home environment. Now I'm going to get to the but. So when we looked at the challenges, the first of one is we drastically overestimated the children's skill level to the extent that when we started running drills, we had drills and games that they couldn't do. And we've written some stuff about this that, you know, some of the research assistants who were in there teaching, the kids didn't have the right shoes, so we couldn't teach. We had to teach them to run because they didn't have some of these basic motor skills. So we had to change our approach because we didn't estimate the skill level very well. We had troubles with behavior and listening types of things. This is a bit like when you have a sub-teacher and the kids want to take advantage a little bit. We were the kind of sub-teachers, and we had some creative solutions to this from our community partners. One of the teachers in one of the schools stayed to basically police behavior, and parents turned up. And parents turned up, and they actually helped translate as much as anything else, because we didn't plan for the need to have translation from English to various languages, that we just didn't expect this in our naivety. In terms of the life skills, leadership and confidence were extremely difficult for us to teach, and they were extremely difficult for the kids to learn. It's possible that they were not developmentally appropriate choices. It's possible they were too abstract of a skill. It's also likely that the simple reflective technique that we used is not sufficient to promote leadership and confidence. Teamwork, yeah, that was no problem. It was very concrete for the kids. We could show them examples of teamwork, but not so much with leadership and confidence. So what? This is kind of early stage stuff that we were just trying to do something in response to a community need. So I would say that maybe we can deliver community programs, maybe we should do it. I think the fact that we included partners and especially included kids in getting that feedback was probably a strength. We have this flexible approach, we worked with the schools, you didn't need much equipment. And there is some evidence that transfer might be possible, so transfer skills from sport. I'm just gonna finish. I put the publications we've got up there. I just want to finish with a little, just to tell you a little bit about from our other research and from this. I think we've got to be really careful about presenting sport as this solution to a range of social ills. We tried to teach three basic life skills, and we struggled. We only really taught one. We see sport presented as sport can do this, that, and the other. I think we need to be surgical in our use of sport. We need to specifically target some outcomes and develop and deliver programs that address those outcomes. Very briefly, we've just finished a CIHR-funded project. We're still doing it for the last 3 years. And we looked at an inner-city hockey program delivered for homeless people. And we analyzed the benefits of this program. And the benefits were there was an outlet for the aggression, they got a shower once a week, and they could develop relationships with the person who ran the program, who was a social worker. So the benefits were extremely limited, but nonetheless important. And I think we need to realize that the benefits of sport are limited, but nonetheless important. Thank you.